Hello, we're going to have a look at what secondary storage is, what it's used for, and some of the main secondary storage devices. So, secondary storage is non-volatile memory that is used to store programs and files long term. So, non-volatile means when power is turned off, all of the data is being retained. It being long term means it won't just last for an hour or a day or a week, but it'll sit there permanently until we delete it. So we've got secondary storage. We also have primary storage. Primary storage is RAM and ROM, which begs the question, why can't we use RAM and ROM for this long-term purpose? Well, we can't use RAM to hold stuff long-term because it's volatile, meaning when power is turned off, it loses all of the data. So pretty useless for long-term storage if it is wiped the second power is turned off. But ROM isn't volatile, so why can't we use ROM? Well, ROM has an issue in that it is read-only. We can't easily write data to ROM, so it's again a non-starter. That's why we need to have other storage, which is secondary storage. A big misconception is people hear the word secondary and think, oh, secondary storage is a backup to primary storage. Maybe it's not essential, but it is essential if we want to store programs or files long-term. We just can't use RAM, we can't use ROM. All of the programs on your computer, all of your files and documents and pictures on your computer are being stored in secondary storage. They're just copied into RAM when you open them. Just two terms which you may come across, you may not, but they are on my specification and I don't want you to get thrown because these aren't words we normally use in everyday life. You might hear the term storage medium. You might also hear the term storage media. And the only difference between these two terms is medium is singular, media is plural. A storage medium is another way of saying we've got a storage device. And storage media, another way of saying we've got storage devices. So don't get thrown by those terms. Now, the main thing you have to know about this topic is, beyond what's on the slide, are the three types of secondary storage. And you need to be able to give some examples of storage media for these three types and evaluate them. So let's do that now. The three types of secondary storage are optical, magnetic, and solid state. Now, we don't need to know about these in detail in terms of how they work. You don't need to waste time revising specifics about how these work, but let me give you just a brief overview just so you've got a sense of how they are working. So all of these devices have to store data in binary because that's what a computer uses. Optical storage stores data in binary by creating two different ways that light can reflect. One of those ways represents a zero, one of those ways represents a one. And it does this by having a disk, which has on the disk's surface some flat bits and some holes. Those holes are called pits. And a laser will get shone on the disk's surface. If it's a flat bit, it'll reflect upwards, and so it can detect it as a zero, for example. But parts of the disk will have bumpy bits with a pit, and the laser shone on this bit, it won't reflect in the same way, it will reflect at an angle. And that's how it can detect that this is different from the zero. This will be detected as a one. So to store binary data, it will just create holes on the disk's surface, which will reflect light differently to represent ones. It will leave bits flat, which represent zeros. That, in a nutshell, is how optical disks work. And the main examples of optical storage are CDs, DVDs, and Blu-rays, which all look the same. You've all seen these before. They're not used nearly as much as they were 20 years ago. But we still use these for video games and things like that for the time being. The difference between a CD, a DVD, and a Blu-ray is that each one of those has progressively higher capacities. One thing which is important to understand when you are evaluating is an optical disc is useless on its own. We need to put this disc into an optical disc drive. The optical disc drive contains that laser, which is able to shine on the disc and read off either zeros or ones. So most laptops don't have these anymore. In fact, most desktop computers don't have these anymore. So that could be a limitation of using a Blu-ray disc because your device doesn't have access to an optical disc drive. Now, magnetic storage, again, has to represent data in binary. It does this by using two different magnetic orientations. And we can just think of this as being like a compass. A compass has got different magnetic directions, north, south, east, west. We can picture, for example, if it's facing upwards, that's representing a one. If it's facing towards east, that's representing a zero. And so on the disk surface, there'll be loads and loads of different particles which are either magnetized towards north or magnetized towards east, and that's representing the binary data. It's really hard to imagine having billions, if not trillions, of these different particles on a disk's surface, all in different directions, but that is how magnetic storage works. And the main example we have of magnetic storage is a hard drive, or formerly called a hard disk drive, shortened to HDD. Hard drives have been in action for a long time and were the dominant storage for a very long time. If we were to open up a hard drive, we would see a disk similar to a CD. A CD is spinning when it is inside an optical disk drive, as is the disk in a hard drive. So when this is working, this disk is spinning around really, really fast, about 7,000 times a minute. And this, what's called a read-write head, is detecting magnetism on the disk surface in order to read binary data. And when it is writing data to the disk, it's changing these magnetic orientations to be either 0 or 1. And I mentioned this spinning because you won't be asked about how this works, but you will need to understand that it is moving really quite fast. And having a device which is moving really quite fast affects things like its durability and its noise and the heat being generated. And those are disadvantages of these two types. They both make noise, they both generate more heat. Solid state storage will generate some heat, but it generates next to no noise because solid state storage just uses circuitry to represent binary data. So we use circuits that are able to be in either one of two different states. In other words, these are just like switches. A switch can be either off or on. If a switch is off, that could represent binary 0. If a switch is on, it can represent binary 1. So a single switch can represent 1 bit. If I want to store a terabyte, I need trillions of switches in circuits. But that's how solid state storage works. We've got a few types of solid state storage because these are now the dominant type of storage we use. So SSDs are the equivalent of a hard disk drive. An SSD stands for solid state drive. They come in a few different form factors. These are one of the latest ones, which go straight onto your motherboard. And if we opened it up, we would see nothing very exciting. We would just see circuitry and wiring and nothing very noticeable. There aren't any moving parts inside this device. And that's also the case with a USB flash drive. Please don't call these USBs. That's not what they are. You can call them USB flash drives, memory sticks, USB sticks. Just don't call them USBs. They plug into the USB port and again have very similar internal components to an SSD. And to give you a third example, an SD card is used a lot with cameras, goes into a camera, and again is just a bunch of switches which represent binary by being either on or off. Now, the thing which you are most likely to be examined on is giving some examples. Now, you are likely to need to be able to give examples like these in the exam, potentially based on a scenario. So recommend one of these storage media based on the scenario. But commonly, you are also asked to evaluate these. And there are certain key terms which we should be using in your answers. These are all of the ones listed on the specification. These are the ones they will be expecting you to use. So let's start with durability. Durability is how well the device is able to withstand damage. Hard drives have got spinning disks, spinning really quite fast. Anything mechanical is more prone to breaking if it's dropped or gets bumped into. So they're not very durable, hard drives. Solid state drives are actually perfectly fine most of the time. If I drop a solid state drive, it should be okay because it's got no moving parts. CDs and other optical discs are not very durable. They can be scratched. They can have dust, which can affect them being read. Scratching and dust will affect it because it will interfere with the light being reflected, so it doesn't read the binary correctly. Reliability is how well you can trust the device to work over time. If one day you log on and it starts to not work, that means it is not being reliable. To be honest, all of these technologies are quite old at this point and are quite stable. However, SSDs do have an issue where they only have a finite number of writes possible. What that means is after around 100,000 times of you saving to the SSD, it will start to stop working. This is down to just how SSDs work. Hard drives also can have reliability issues after a few years, more due to them being mechanical, and mechanical parts wear out and start to get damaged after sometimes 4 or 5 years. With hard drives, you can typically start to tell if they are about to fail because you'll get errors or it'll be really, really slow. So you do sometimes get warning with hard drives, which can be helpful. In terms of speed, there is only one winner here. SSDs are the fastest type of storage device to both read and write. We don't just say fastest, we say fastest to read and write, the two separate operations here. Portability is how easy it is to move these devices around. USB flash drives and SD cards are small and light, so are really portable. They have less capacity than bigger, bulkier SSDs or hard drives, but they are very portable, as are, to be fair, CDs, DVDs, and Blu-rays, because these are thin and light. They can be moved around very easily. In terms of cost, we don't need to be able to evaluate every single different device compared to each other, but generally speaking, SSDs are the most expensive per gigabyte. Don't just say SSDs are expensive. Try and quantify that by saying per gigabyte, because obviously it depends on how much capacity you're getting. But SSDs, partly because they are the fastest and the most complicated to make potentially, they are the most expensive. And capacity is how much binary data can be stored on these different devices. We have to think about this in terms of per device or per unit, because obviously you could just buy more of these devices. But out of all the ones we talked about, hard drives typically have the largest capacity per device, certainly per pound you are expending. So in terms of cost, we would say hard drives are the cheapest per gigabyte. Hard drives can typically have multiple terabytes of storage. SSDs can have multiple terabytes too, but normally not nearly as much as hard drives. So these points are the key ones I think you need to commit to memory and be able to bring out when asked. But part of it is thinking on your feet. You need to be able to just consider the scenario you're being given, what type of storage is most suitable, using the words on this slide.